Good afternoon and Merry Christmas. Welcome to Bethany Lutheran Church. I'm going to struggle with this a little bit. My name is Mark Dahlke. I'm not a real preacher. You'll notice that as the service goes along. But we're still without a pastor. And this keeps cutting out, so that kind of is going to be par for the course probably tonight. I may have to switch this over. So, at any rate, welcome. And thank you for attending this evening, this afternoon. Just a couple of announcements. First of all, we're very happy that you're with us today, and we really send out a special warm welcome to any visitors, relatives, friends of members of our church, or if you're just in the area, it's great to have you here and celebrate Christ's birth and our Christmas Eve service. Maybe I could ask one of the ushers if they could go back in the pastor's office, and there's another one of these. Dave, if you could. A couple announcements. The most important one first, of course, and that is if you're going to leave an offering tonight, there'll be a basket in the narthex or just as you exit in the aisle. There'll also be one back in the fellowship hall if anyone is sitting back there. Also, you were asked to grab a card this evening as you came in and put your name on that. And the reason for that is for contact tracing purposes, in case that we have any issue with COVID, which we hope that we won't have anything like that. If you purchased a poinsettia and are interested in taking one home after the service, please feel free to come up and grab one. We will be lighting an individual candle during the singing of Silent Night, and we will demonstrate kind of how to do that right before that song, as we hope to avoid any wax on the carpeting. It's a little hard to get out. So we'll just kind of quickly do that. Before we start, just a, not going to fight that anymore. We're going to just have a few thoughts about Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve is a time for our hearts, more so than our minds. Everything about tonight invites us to feel something rather than to have to think too hard. More than any other service of the year, we come today not wanting to hear proof and reasons for some mystery of God, but rather we want to feel and experience the warmth of the love of God, especially on this special night of Christmas Eve. Our service today is a celebration and praise to God for the love he has shown us by bringing salvation by his son's birth. Tonight, may we feel Jesus' presence and know that we are indeed saved. At this time, if you can stand as you are able, please do so. You can follow along in the bulletin or up in front on the monitors. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light.
Celebrate the coming of the light.
O sing to the Lord a new song. God's salvation is at hand.
Celebrate the coming of salvation.
For a child has been born for us, a son given to us.
Celebrate the coming of the Prince of Peace.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
and also with you.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Lord, we are so excited. Christmas Eve is here. We are impatient to hear the whole story. Slow us down again, Lord. As we hear Mary say yes to God's good news, help us to remember that God continually calls us to be those who will bear the good news to those in need. Forgive us when we forget to do that. Enable us to go into your world offering our lives, our gifts, and our talents. For your glory, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll have now the first reading.
On this Christmas Eve, the first reading is from Isaiah chapter 9. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders. And he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from the book of Titus, chapter 2. The grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. 1:26. The angel came to Mary and said, "Greetings, the Lord has blessed you and is with you." But Mary was very startled by what the angel said and wondered what this greeting might mean. The angel said, "Do not be afraid, Mary. God has shown you his grace. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of the King David, his ancestor. He will rule over the people of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end." Mary said to the angel, "How will this happen, since I am a virgin?" The angel said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Holy and Most High will cover you. For this reason, the baby will be holy and will be called the Son of God." "I am the servant of the Lord," Mary said. "May your word be fulfilled in me." Then the angel left her.
I am the Lord's servant. Mary responded to the angel with those words and never looked back. She was able to turn over her fears, her insecurities, her questions to the Lord because she had such strong faith. And because of this strong faith, her heart opened to the will of God. The Holy Spirit then covered her, and she was able to carry out the responsibilities of being the mother of Jesus. Well, we too certainly have our fears, our insecurities, uncertainties in our lives. But if we strive to have a faith like Mary, to be the Lord's servant, the Holy Spirit will cover us too, bringing peace, bringing calm to us when things seem to be unmanageable.
from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
Consider what Joseph had to face. His wife was pregnant, but yet they had not been together in marriage. No doubt Mary's pregnancy raised suspicions and accusations of adultery, which was a violation of Jewish law and actually punishable by death. Now, although we don't know a whole lot about Joseph, the way he handled this difficult situation shows us that he was a compassionate and caring man. Instead of leaving Mary to face embarrassment, banishment from society, and potentially death, he decided to divorce her, but he planned to do so quietly and privately. But then an angel appears to him and explained that Mary was chosen by God, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, she would be the mother of the Son of God. Joseph unselfishly put his feelings aside, and instead he trusted the Lord and decided to continue on as husband and wife. Joseph knew he would face certain scrutiny and criticism from family and friends and probably the religious community for marrying a woman who was pregnant with a child that was not his. However, even though this was probably very difficult and hard to do, Joseph's faith guided him to do the right thing. Joseph's kindness and understanding can serve as a model for us when we experience hurt and confusion by others' actions or words. And like Joseph, we should take a breath and wait before reacting, because we may not know all the facts, or we may not know what people might be going through in their personal lives. When our egos tell us to respond one way, our faith can direct us in a better direction. When a situation requires compassion, our patience, and our grace, we can look to Joseph's example with Mary and choose to do the right thing also. Mary and Joseph probably averaged about 10 to 12 miles a day walking over the hilly desert terrain on their way to Bethlehem. The trip took at least 6 to 8 days to complete. Their nights were no doubt uncomfortable, sleeping in cold weather, and Mary near the end of her pregnancy. Under these difficult conditions, we wonder how many times they must have thought about just turning back and going home. But Mary and Joseph's story is about a journey built on faith. Rather than focus on their hardships, they concentrated on fulfilling God's plan. Sometimes God has us on difficult journeys too. And while these journeys might not be as dramatic as traveling on foot for 90 miles and delivering the Son of God, sometimes they still are challenging for us. Our difficult journeys might include things like God asking us to make a little more room in our lives for Him, or find time and resources to help those who are less fortunate than us. Maybe God asks us to forgive those who have wronged us, or make time for His work in our church or in our community. When these God journeys become hard, uncomfortable, or inconvenient, we may have a tendency to want to turn back toward home. But if that happens, and when that happens, we can look to Mary and Joseph for inspiration, to have the kind of faith like theirs, faith that carried them to Bethlehem and delivered God's Son, who brought salvation to the world. It is likely Joseph and Mary stayed with relatives in Bethlehem. And even though Scripture said there was no space for them in the inn, the Greek translation for inn is kataluma, which actually means a guest chamber. Therefore, there was no room for them in the home's guest chamber. Jesus was probably born in a lower room of a typical house where animals were brought in at night for their protection, and their body heat provided some warmth for the house. And often a feeding trough or manger was carved into the wall of this room. Thank you.
region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord." The angel said to the shepherds, "This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and laying in a manger."
Shepherds were considered among the lowest class of people at that time. They were stereotyped as liars and thieves, prone to use bad language and tend to want to fight. Many towns actually barred them from their city limits, and the religious establishment kind of looked down on them because their shepherding duties often kept them from attending religious services. But God decided to reveal the news of the birth of his son to these shunned people because he wanted to show the world that his love is for all people, despite their station in life. God's love for the shepherds is a reminder to us that he wants us to love and care for the shepherds in our communities. And how can we do that? Can we do more for our local food pantries or other charities? We know that there are endless opportunities for volunteering. Or maybe it's as simple as no longer ignoring the person with the cardboard sign in the boulevard and instead handing them $5.
Luke 2:15. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem to see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about the child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, and as it has been told to them.
What do we do with good news? Do we keep it to ourselves, or do we share it? Of course, we typically tell our family, friends, any good news that we might have. Yet, we often find it hard to share the good news of Jesus Christ, don't we? We feel sometimes self-conscious or uncomfortable talking to others about our faith, afraid that talking about religion might be a little too personal. But spreading the good news does not mean that we always have to approach strangers or knock on doors or stand on a street corner evangelizing. Instead, we can find our own ways to speak with others about Jesus and help them understand what his birth really means for all people. We hope our message tonight is a gentle reminder of things that you can carry with you throughout the year. As we look back on tonight's story of Christ's birth, we heard about the compassion and grace shown to Mary by Joseph. We should strive to carry this kind of understanding and carry that spirit in our hearts, so that maybe when we encounter difficult people, we respond with the same grace and compassion as Joseph. We also learned that the love of God showed to the shepherds is the kind of love we should show to our neighbor who is less fortunate than us and maybe help with their basic needs. And in this season of giving and receiving gifts, it is important that, like the shepherds, we share this good news that Jesus' birth provided the greatest gift of all, salvation. Salvation that brings forgiveness of sins and the promise of eternal life. As we reflect on Mary and Joseph's unwavering faith, may we strive for that same faith and know that miraculous things can happen in our lives too. To each of you and all your loved ones, may you have a wonderful and blessed Christmas. Amen.
gracious God, your word made flesh brings harmony to the earth. As we offer ourselves in these gifts, prepare us to receive the grace and the truth that you offer at this table, and renew us, in us, the song of your salvation, in Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. Amen.
Please rise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and he gave thanks. And he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you can in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us when we come into your kingdom, as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. This time I would like you to prepare. Take the bread, the body of Christ, broken for you. Take and eat. Now take the wine, the blood of Christ, shed for you, for the forgiveness of sin. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his most precious blood, may he strengthen and preserve you unto everlasting life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us pray. Most High God, you have come among us at this table this evening. By the Spirit's power, form us to be bearers of your word, sharing gifts of mercy and grace with all, through Christ Jesus, our host and our guest.
Amen.
May be seated.
At this time, we're going to demonstrate proper lighting, I guess, of the candles, and after we do that, the ushers will be coming around and lighting your candle for those who are sitting on the inside here of the pew. So the unlit candle is the one that you would tilt towards the lighted and then so on and so forth. So always the unlit tilt towards the lit, always keep upright, and then hold them upright until we get the whole congregations, all the candles lit, and then we will begin silent night. So at this time, I'll ask the ushers to come around and Stilla Nacht, Silent Night, was first performed on Christmas Eve in 1818 in an Austrian village church. A young priest, Joseph Moore, wrote the lyrics a couple of years before and took them to Franz Gruber, an organist of the church, so that he would compose a melody for that night's church service. Because the church organ was damaged, Gruber composed the melody on guitar. We have the pleasure tonight of hearing Silent Night on the instrument for which it was originally composed.
Oh.
please stand. Raise your candles. Pleasure of seeing from here how beautiful that looked and how beautiful that sounded. And it's quite a sight and quite a moment. We'll now have the benediction. Go now in wonder. Go to bring light to those in darkness, joy to those who can find no joy. Go with the songs of angels in your ears and the love of God in your hearts. Go and spread the word. The babe of Bethlehem is born for all.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.